Hey, fellow travel lovers, my name is Kaya Masniak, and welcome to The Sweet Escape. This is WMC's very first travel show, and I'm just so excited. This is going to be so much fun. Each episode will be dedicated to a country that I have personally traveled to, and we're going to be talking about topics such as food, history, culture, myths, religion, hidden gems, dark tourism, and so much more. And I know you can only listen to my voice for so long, so I'm gonna be inviting guests and acquaintances to come on because they're gonna be the ultimate experts and they're gonna talk about celebrating their heritage and their personal connection to that country, as well as giving tips for college student budget traveling. Woo! Because I'm a college student myself and I haven't been employed for 3 years. I'm not necessarily proud of that, but I'm also always gonna be looking for freebies and just discounts and the cheapest things to do while having fun. So if you're interested, put on your, you know, travel hats and let's get started. I just want to give a little disclaimer before I actually start the show. So there are going to be vacation photos that I'm going to be sharing, but I'm also going to be using photos that I just found from a simple Google search, and I'll make sure to include the links in the description as well as information that I found when I was doing research on Singapore. I am not a walking encyclopedia. I got this information from research. So yeah, I just want you to know that. This is a lot of the information I'm going to be talking about will be cited. We don't care about nothing else. The sweet escape feels like heaven. Nothing can stop us now. We run away. A sweet escape. Nothing can hold us down. Just like a wave that never breaks. Nothing can stop us now. And by National Geographic and recognized as Southeast Asia's most modern city for over a century, this ethnically rich sovereign island nation is located on the southernmost point of Malay Peninsula. Divided by the Straits of Johor, the main island spans across 18 square miles and is surrounded by 54 smaller islands. The southernmost parts of the island nation is only 10 miles away from the Riau Islands province in Indonesia. Can you guess this country just by its geography? If not, that's fine, because it probably just got revealed in the intro. But anyway, and I'm also starting to get like Dora the Explorer vibes, so I'm just gonna stop right there. But it's Singapore, yay! Singapore is among the 9 island nations in Asia, alongside the Philippines, Sri Lanka, the Maldives, Japan, Indonesia, East Timor, Taiwan, and Brunei Darussalam. Being a city and a country, Singapore is quite small. However, it has a very diverse climate and environment. Its location and harbor are seen as economic jewels, though a bit hilly, if that's even a word. The island's highest point is the 165 meter high built Tima Park. Fun fact, Singapore's land area size increased by 25% over the past 2 centuries. How is that exactly, you ask? Through land reclamation projects, of course. For those of you that don't know what the heck land reclamation means, I got you through a simple Google search. I'm ready. So it's the method of creating new land space by filling the chosen area with lots of heavy rock, cement, clay, soil, and in Singapore's case, sand. The first land reclamation project took place during the colonial times. In 1822, the Esplanade Rochor River beachfront, also north of Singapore River, was the apple of British statesman's Stamford Raffles' eye. He wanted to turn the beachfront into a commercial district suitable for incoming imports. The south bank of the beachfront invited many floods, being like a gigantic marsh and all. The nearby hillock was leveled out to give rise to more land space. The land reclamation project lasted 4 months and resulted in creating the famous crescent-shaped Boat Quay. The left side of the hillock became the commercial district known as Raffles Place. Many more land reclamation projects span from the 19th century all the way to the 21st, and Singapore is planning more in the foreseeable future. According to the 2013 Land Use Plan devised by the Ministry of National Development, the demand for more land space is increasing as by 2030, the national population will probably rise from already 5.7 million to 6.5 or 6.9 million people. Quite interesting. And I'm learning more about Singapore than I knew like 5 years ago when I was actually visiting it. Singapore is a densely populated city with outstanding urban infrastructure, but years of urbanization removed 95% of Singapore's natural forests. And as a nature geek, that really hit me hard. The Singaporean government did recognize their deforestation trends and declared Singapore as the Garden City in 1967, which is literally what makes Singapore like so unique and fairy tale like, and was probably one of the reasons why my dad and I were drawn to visit it in the first place. 10% of Singapore belongs to nature reserves and parks. The best nature spots claimed by several travel sites is the Bukit Timah Nature Reserve Park, home to lizards, snakes, and monkeys, the Makrachi Nature Trail, a treetop walking trail, Cloud Forest, an inside plant life wonderland, and Singapore Botanic Gardens, home to the National Orchid Garden. Before colonization of Singapore in 1819, the tropical forests, mangroves, and swamps dispersed throughout the entire island. As mentioned before, urbanization and deforestation through land reclamation projects soon changed the nation's landscape. Small sectors of mangrove forests can be found on the northern part of the main island. The legacy of the evergreen rainforest remains in the Bukit Timah Nature Reserve. Singapore is famous for its orchids and has more than 3,000 different species, many of which you can find in the National Orchid Garden. The national flower is the Vanda Miss Joaquim orchid. I mean, it's gorgeous with accents of white and purple with a gold slash yellow ring right in the middle. Definitely a flower I would love to have in my house, but they're notoriously just difficult to actually keep alive. Singapore's fauna, or in other words, wildlife, is very rich. According to visitsingapore.org, the island is home to 80 species of mammals, 300 species of birds, 110 species of reptiles, and 600 species of freshwater fish. Yum! Sustainability and environmentalism is a big deal in Singapore, hence why they call themselves the Garden City. Urban development is incorporating green building into new architectural projects, such as green rooftops, gardens, and verdant walls. Green building has been a mandatory since 2008, thanks to Dr. Cheung, the first female leader in Singapore's Urban Development Agency, and she is now the CEO of the Housing and Development Board, building public housing for Singaporean residents. Through an interview with National Geographic, Dr. Cheung stated, quote, through an incentive program, we replaced greenery lost on the ground from development with greenery in the sky through high-rise terraces and gardens. This adds another layer of space for recreation and gathering. In Marina Bay, all developments comply with 100% greenery replacement policy. The Pinnacle at Duxton, the tallest public housing development in the world, has 7 50-story buildings connected by gardens on the 26th and 50th floors. You can even jog around the track on those levels, and they're also equipped with exercise stations, end quote. And many Google images will show you that parks and gardens are spread out throughout the entire city, innovating the concept of parks and recreation that is so far from what we see even in the biggest cities in America. The perfect recipe of Singapore's tropical climate, high temperatures and high humidity accommodates the surrounding rainforests, tropical plant life, and city gardens. According to Britannica.com, average temperatures range from 81 degrees Fahrenheit to 77 degrees Fahrenheit year-round. Singapore has two monsoon seasons. The northeast monsoon season takes place from December to early March, and it is a windy and dry season. And the southwest monsoon season takes place from June to September, aka the rainy season. The more you know. It's not how the jingle goes, but that's fine. Before I move on to my storytelling segment, I would like to throw some fun facts about Singapore that will shock you and leave your mind blown. I've gathered fun facts from the following websites: worldstrides.com, usnews.com, onceinalifetimejourney.com, So let's get to it. There was a period of time where Singapore didn't even exist on the map. Being a trading hotspot in the heart of Asia, Portuguese pirates wanted to get their fair share and burn the city in 1613. The city was devastated, and it wasn't until 1819 when Sir Stamford Raffles built a British trading post and reintroduced Singapore to the world. Sang Nila Utama, a prince from Palembang, saw a creature that he thought was a lion and therefore named the island Singapura, which means Lion City in Sanskrit. However, there's been no lions spotted in Singapore since. If anything, you could find them in the Singapore Zoo. The colors on Singapore's flag symbolize a lot, starting with red, which means universal brotherhood, and white, which means purity and virtue. Singapore's time zone has been changed 7 times, including in World War II, when Singapore was under Japan's occupation. They changed Singapore's time zone to match Japan's time zone. And most recently in 1982, Malaysia changed Singapore's time zone to match theirs, which I think makes more sense because they're right next to each other. So, I mean, it's logical. Cars are extremely expensive in Singapore. Here in New Jersey, as soon as you turn 17, you head to the DMV, you pass your driver's test, and you get a car immediately. In Singapore, cars are a commodity because Singapore is such a densely populated city. There's pretty much no room for so many cars, and traffic jams are a friend to no one. Due to high taxes and an expensive permit, owning a car is insanely expensive. Apparently, cars in Singapore are 3 times more expensive than cars in Europe. How is that fair? But no worries, because we find out that Singaporeans are apparently the fastest walking people in the entire world. Singaporeans are just naturally gifted walkers. Singapore does not allow massively tall buildings. A building could only go up to 85 stories and not any higher, considering that they have a military base that's very close by, and they don't want buildings to interfere with training. Singapore is considered one of the safest countries in the entire world. Violent crimes and just extreme crime rates are just almost non-existent. Apparently, residents sleep with their windows wide open. I think that's really kind of, I think it's such a luxury just to like sleep with your window open, not be afraid of anything. Like, that's so sweet. That's nice. The National Orchid Garden is one of the very few UNESCO heritage sites. One of the most popular movies in Singapore is Avatar, which brought in $10 million in 2009, which kind of makes sense because later on you'll see that Alvin, my friend, actually refers to Avatar, and you'll see why. And now that we're done with the fun facts, we can move on to my 2015 vacation in Singapore. I do have to let you guys know that as I'm going to be storytelling, there's so much that I don't remember because the last time I was there was like 5 years ago. Like, I don't even want to admit that I'm turning 20, but I am, and it makes me feel so sad. But yeah, so I'm going to look at pictures. I'm going to do my absolute best. And if I forget a title of a location or a landmark that I saw, I'll make sure to caption it in the picture. But one of the only ways that I actually remember my vacations is by looking at pictures. So since it was like 5 years since I actually been in Singapore, I don't necessarily remember how long I stayed in Singapore, but it was a very short time. So it could have been 3 days or 2 days. And then my dad and I moved on to a different country afterwards. But I think on the first night, I think we came in pretty late. It was nighttime. And I remember, okay, so there's 2 things that could have happened. The first thing is that I either had dinner with my dad at the hotel that we were staying at, or we actually met Alvin, my dad's best friend who lives in Singapore, and we went to the top of the NBS hotel, the hotel with the famous boat on top. They have a rooftop restaurant and we stayed there. That was like the first day, the first night ever in Singapore, and I remember just kind of eating this cake or like this dessert that said welcome to Singapore, and just looking at the view, and it was just, oh my god, it was like a fairy tale come true. So I think that's what happened on the first day. On the second day, my dad and I, we started early because whenever I'm on vacation, I just get so much energy and so much adrenaline. Not that I have any now. So what we did, we walked around a little bit. We walked around Marina Bay for a little bit, and then we actually caught a boat and we went on a boat tour along this river. And I don't necessarily remember the river, the name of the river, or the name of the body of water that we were on, but I'll make sure to caption it in the picture. And yeah, we took a boat tour and we just saw like a bunch of sights. And then I think after the boat tour, we went to the Singapore Botanic Gardens and we saw a bunch of flowers and just like really little tiny like figurines and like this like statue, which looked kind of silly to me, and I made a silly face with it. I don't know why. But I remember like just going to the National Orchid Garden and just being like blown away. And I swear to you, I was literally staring at each flower for like a good 5 minutes. Like, I was like, I've never seen orchids like this before. We definitely don't keep orchids in the house because they're so just, you already know. It was so beautiful. And it was definitely just like an entire photo shoot. My dad was just taking pictures of me with every flower. It definitely could have made a good postcard. I think that's about it. Like I said, I wish I remembered a little bit more, but I guess like one of my favorite memories, and they're very, and it's very just like low key, but I remember after the dinner that I had with my dad and his friend, Alvin, we actually hopped into Alvin's car and he actually drove us around the city a little bit. And I remember just like the roof was off and the wind was in my hair and I was just like listening to music and just vibing. And it was like a really cool experience because it was the first time that I saw Singapore during the nighttime and just Singapore at all. So just that first like culture shock that I experienced, I was like, this is so cool. I want to live here. But yeah, so ultimately I had such a wonderful time in Singapore and I'm so eager to go back because I just want to remember things again. Next up, I invited my friend Alvin to come on and talk about tips for college budget traveling and just his personal connection and his experience living in Singapore. So here's a special treat all the way from Singapore.
Hello, Alvin Yeo. Thank you so much for joining me today. Just to give you guys a little background information as to how I know Alvin, my dad and Alvin are longtime best friends. My memory obviously doesn't recall this, but Alvin first met my dad and I when I was only 3 years old, back in the depths of Bay Ridge, Brooklyn. Due to my dad's chosen career, he was able to travel to Asia frequently, and they were able to meet up for some catch-up time, as adults say. I was fortunate enough to go on a vacation of a lifetime and traveled to Singapore at the age of 15. My dad and I actually met up with Alvin in Singapore, which is the last time I saw him in person. But hopefully that will change soon, and we'll meet again soon. This is the point where I insert a picture of all three of us. So sympathetic. So thank you for joining me, Alvin.
No problem. How are you?
I'm chilling, you know. I woke up earlier today. I feel like it's going to be a productive day. It's a bit cloudy outside, but that's not stopping us. How's the evening in Singapore? Because as you guys know, the time difference is...
Yep, it's 12 hours difference. Yep. Wow. It's good. It has been a good day. It's actually my off day. Had a very lazy day, but catching up on some errands. And then I had to do some workout before dinner. And so I feel really good now. I'm really comfortable getting ready to bed. Sorry?
The dopamine is rushing. You feel productive.
I feel good. Yeah, I feel good. Ready to end this good day with an interview with you?
Yay! It's going to be very fun. It's going to be very casual.
Yep, you better make sure it's fun.
Trying. Okay, so...
Okay, yes.
Let's begin. Singapore is a small but yet a very prosperous city state. You know, you talked about traveling a lot. Were you able to travel within the regions and towns of Singapore? Did you move a little bit or?
Well, Singapore is really small. So
yeah.
It takes like, so if I am to travel from the left of Singapore to the right and most of Singapore, it takes me only 30 minutes. That's how small Singapore is.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, did you not realize it when you were in Singapore?
Honestly, I was so jet lagged and so excited and just fueled on adrenaline that everything looked grand to me.
Not to mention that she was a very lucky girl because I was a chauffeur for the entire trip.
I know. I should have appreciated it more when I was younger, but I was truly excited that you're with
no,
us.
No, you were really kind happy, of, I was I kind remember. Of,
my gosh, Asia is just a dream come true. I
yeah, but
back
Singapore
soon.
Is really small. So, so just like I said, if I am to drive from the west of Singapore to the east of Singapore, or let's say from the east, because our airport is located on the eastmost of Singapore. So if I'm to drive from the airport to the furthest point of Singapore, it takes me about 30, 35 minutes. Yes.
I was actually looking just more information about Singapore, and someone compared Singapore to just being as just lengthy as a few football fields. Is that, would you say that's true?
Well, I mean, if you make it as a joke, it could possibly be, but of course, in reality, well, I'm a math not teacher, fair. Right? So it's not true, of course.
So actually, you mentioned that you're a math teacher, right? And that goes to my next point. When I first learned that you interact with adolescents and just very young adults on a daily basis, it really truly surprised me. So would you mind telling us a little bit more about your career?
So I actually founded a school about 13 years ago. So I'm a math teacher, but I also hire teachers to teach in my school. We specialize in mathematics and English. And of course, my passion lies in mathematics. So my students are from the age of like 14 to 18 years old, but I really enjoy teaching the age from like 16 to 18 because you're like kind of hanging out with young adults. And I guess the reason why I feel myself so different from all my friends is because I hang with you guys practically for the last 15 years of my life. And I'm still stuck at the age of like speaking like a 20-year-old. And until the last 3 years, I have been always hanging out with my students. Like my students are actually my closest friends for a period of time.
Wow.
Until now, the gap is really simply just too big. Like now I'm 40 and my students are like 18. So there's like a 22-year-old gap. But before that, when I first started my career, I was like 28 and my students were like 18. It was just like a 10-year gap. And I was like their big brother. I remember after class, we would always hang out. I would drive them around and then we would have like supper together or dinner together. So yeah, that's cool. And I guess that makes me as a happier person because I just mix with young people.
Honestly, I can't even think of a tutoring service that ever, like even here that I've ever been to, that just was just so community based and just so close to it, the students. I always felt like there was a gap between that. I just felt like everything was just high intense pressure, especially if I was taking SAT classes or if I was studying for any other exam. It was just kind of strict, like here we are, by the book, let's do the practice problems. And I have a very creative mind, and I kind of have like an ants in my pants type of just attitude. I just am buzzing all the time. And to have someone that truly cares, right, and understands that and tries to kind of gravitate just a little bit more fun, right, a little bit more fun and just relatable content, right, just be relatable with the students. That's really important because it motivates them, right? And I wish that I was motivated like that by my tutors or teachers, right? I would have had a higher GPA in high school.
Well, as a side track, your dad has always wanted me to teach you personally Chinese as a language.
Really?
Well, I declined him.
That's good.
Well, no, but speaking back to the industry, like tutoring, the tutoring industry is really huge in Singapore. Like based on the last statistics I've checked, like every four out of five children have had tutoring experiences. That means they have joined a tuition center or they have been tutored by a private coach or tutor before in their lives, during their education life. It's part of our culture. So, but like what you've just mentioned, I think in the tuition industry in Singapore, there's two groups, or there are two categories or two kinds of tutoring approach. One is the very rigid system still, which is like you go in, it's very intense. It's all results driven. The classes are big. You come and go. There's no connection with the tutor, but they do efficiently still bring you to the point or to the place that you want, to the grade that you want. And there are also some smaller establishments like mine, which because of the size, we are smaller and we are more like home-based. And so we spend more time with students. We do not need to handle like 100 students. We handle like 20, 30. And that's why we have more time to build a connection with the students that we tutor. And I just literally like to spend time with them. So yeah, it's the best job. I wouldn't even call it a job. It's part of me. It's really the best thing that has happened to me in my life.
It's a lifestyle.
Yeah. And before that, interestingly enough, I was an architect. So my degree was in architecture. And I gave up architecture for tutoring. Yeah. And everybody thought I was crazy.
But you didn't, right?
No. I think that was the best decision in my life.
Wow. I never knew that about you, Alvin. Wow. Yeah. We spent a couple of days together about a couple years ago, and I never knew that. Wow.
Well, we're too busy playing games in the car, and I was too busy listening to all your stories as well. So
I have such a pea-sized memory that I really am starting to recall things now as you're telling me. So as you spend a lot of time with these students, and obviously you're very passionate about it and you find this to be a really rewarding experience, I'm sure you've gotten a good grasp of the best of Singapore through the eyes of the students, right? Through like that young adult kind of perspective. So being a college student myself, I would love to find a great way to explore Singapore, especially without having to travel with my dad and maybe by myself or with a couple of acquaintances, right? In a fun but cost-efficient way. So what would you say are the ultimate tourist hot spots in terms of attractions and landmarks to visit on the broke college student bucket list?
I mean, even though I'm an adult, as a Singaporean, we always like free things. So I do have a few recommendations. I always like to spend time going to parts of Singapore that I don't really need to spend the extra cash, and yet still be able to appreciate what we have in the country. I think, firstly, there are a lot of things that you can see in Singapore that doesn't really cost you even a single cent. You just need to walk, because Singapore is so small. So if I'm your age, I would just probably rent a bicycle and just cycle around the whole island, because you could easily cover the entire country within 2 days and see everything that you need to. If everybody Googles Singapore, the first thing you will see on Google would be the famous hotel. It's called the MBS Hotel, which is a Marina Bay Sands Hotel, which is the one that has like a floating boat above the three towers. And I think if you come to Singapore, that's the first building or first architecture that you have to see for yourself. And the view is different from all angles, like when you go in the daytime or you go in the evening when the sun is about to set, because the facade of the building is actually a reflective facade. So as the sun goes down, like the whole building starts to change in color, starts to glitter in the whole environment. You would see like, it's just an amazing view to kind of just take in, and it's free of charge. And around the hotel, there's a very nice lake that you can just walk around. And behind the hotel, there's an amazing garden. If you Google Singapore as well, it's a famous garden. It's called Gardens by the Bay. I'm not quite sure if you actually went to the gardens on your last trip here.
No. Maybe the gardens. I've been to the National Orchid Garden.
Yeah, I remember you saying that. I think the gardens was not ready when you were here. So it's just directly behind the hotel. It's called Gardens by the Bay, and it's a very pretty garden. I jogged there No, not every morning. I jog there like maybe once or twice a week. So
that's impressive. That's goals right there.
that is really a pretty garden. What's interesting about it is that it looks like this movie that I have not watched before. It's called the, you know, the movie whereby all the people are blue in color.
Avatar.
Yes. Yes.
Avatar.
Yeah.
Oh, so like the Pandora Island.
So the garden actually reminds you of the movie itself. You should check it out. Like do some Googling and you know what I mean. Yeah. So
it's giving me vibes of like the Pandora Island in Epcot and Disney World. They have like this whole tropical, like just floating island.
Speaking of that, yes, I remember. I remember you are a big fan of Disney.
True. Of course I had to allude to that. I'm sorry.
yeah, good point. Yeah. Okay, so speaking of that, so this is like the first main attraction. If you are to come to Singapore, whether you are just a student, whether you're like a rich millionaire, everybody goes to MBS to take a look at hotel. Everyone would walk around the hotel, walk around the lake, go to the gardens. And of course, if you want to spend a couple of bucks to get like a glass of wine or a beer, but which is quite expensive, you can actually go all the way up to the hotel, go to the roof, and there are a few nice bars where you can like just chill with your friends, look over the view from the highest floor. I forgot how many stories are there, but it's really quite high, and then you could take
it is high.
The whole view. Yeah, you can take in the whole view of Singapore and the gardens. Okay, so now, what else can you do as a student if you want to look for? I have a recommendation. I actually went there with your dad before.
Okay.
I'm not sure if he told you about it. So there's this island called Pulau Ubin.
Oh.
Yeah. So it's a very small island. You have to take a boat, which is about like 30 minutes or 20 minutes from mainland of Singapore. And then it costs you like probably less than $10.
Okay,
and then you would go over to the island. How would I describe it? When you hop onto the island, it would bring you back to the 70s or the 60s of the Singapore. So it brings you back in time. Yes, it brings you back in time 50, 70 years.
Wow.
It's a real island. And there are still some locals who live on it. And then what you can do is you just need to rent a bicycle and you can cycle along the entire island. Or if you want, you can just walk and you could see monkeys. You could see like some wildlife, like monitor lizards.
Wow.
You would be able to see like wild pigs. You know what wild pigs are?
Yes, I've seen wild pigs. Can you pet them or do you kind of just stay away from them?
If you see one, you do not move and you walk away because they will come rushing. They're not like the pink pigs that you think they are. They are like the
right. They're like the boars.
Hairy. Yes, the boars.
Yeah.
You're right. Yeah. So it's nice. And you will see some, like if you like nature, you will see mangrove swamps. So yeah, I think that's one of my favorite places in Singapore. And for the entire day, you could like be cycling, sweat it out a bit, see the nature, breathe in some fresh air. And the entire trip for that whole day would cost you less than $15 or $10.
Wow. That is honestly, I'm sold. I'm sold. I'm going.
Yeah. If you are going with your friends, just pack like sandwiches or like canned food and have like a picnic.
Right.
Yeah.
With the boars, right?
No, they don't come out.
I'm kidding. Away from the monkeys too. Monkeys are brutal. I'm gonna tell you straight off because
you love monkeys.
We went
no?
to Bali. I like monkeys, right? It's just don't you remember the jungle that we went to in Bali?
Yes, I remember.
And they were just very aggressive.
I don't know
if they were just food trained, but I remember the first thing when we walked in, I think we just bought like a batch of bananas, right?
Yeah.
And I was holding them in my hand and I had a very long, like, Camino, right? I had a very long Camino and the monkey started climbing on top of it, try to get the banana. And I freaked out so much that I was,
I think the monkeys in Singapore are more they're well trained. They are a bit more
okay. Trained. They're more relaxed.
Yeah, they're probably good. More afraid of you.
okay. Yeah. So that's a very pleasing.
Yeah. So that's a good place to go to in Singapore. If you are on a budget, traveling mm-hmm. to Singapore, because Singapore is really expensive in many people's eyes. But what I think is good about Singapore as well is the location. I mean, geographically, it's in the heart of Asia. So most people who travel to Singapore, you do not need to spend a week or two, unless you have friends living in Singapore or working in Singapore, and you just crash in and then really try to leave the local for 2 weeks. But otherwise, 2 days is more than enough. And then most people who come to Singapore would then hop on the plane and fly to some other neighboring Southeast Asian countries. And most people would fly to, for example, Thailand,
Myanmar, very close too.
Indonesia. Yep. And what else do they, Vietnam. So all these are very accessible, and they are also very cheap in terms of traveling there, in terms of finding budget hotels, in terms of spending on food. So I think Singapore is a good 48-hour kind of trip. If let's say you're on a budget. Yeah, yeah. Yep.
That's right. That's pretty awesome. It's music to our ears, to the college student ears, right?
Well, that you can not, you can still... or not come to Singapore and just find me. I'll always know where to tell you to go.
I'll make sure to let my friends know that Alvin is in Singapore, and he's very hospitable.
And part-time tour guide.
Yes, there we go. So okay, I guess we kind of covered very nature spots, and since Singapore is a very tropical country, there's definitely, we've talked about briefly, the National Orchid Garden or the Singapore Botanic Gardens. Just for more towards photography lovers and nature lovers, is there anything else on the main island that they can just see that isn't maybe in the tourist popular guide on the internet that you just search up?
If you want to go more somewhere more local, there is also, which is pretty near my apartment, there is a popular place. It's called Mount Faber. So Mount Faber is just a small little hill, and then it takes you about 30 minutes to just hike up. Great views of Singapore from the top. What I like about Mount Faber is that it's not as touristy. So let's say if you are a student, you are really big into photography, and you are really someone who just wants to walk and take in all the views and have a quiet moment to yourself, or just hang out with your friends, this is a good place to go to. And the other place is Fort Canning. And I would say that Fort Canning may be more interesting for more people. It used to be a popular tourist spot, but now all the attention has slowly shifted to the gardens by the bay. So Fort Canning is quite quiet. It's actually in the central of Singapore. No, it's actually, it's in the central of Singapore. And it has a lot of history to this hills. I think, if I'm not wrong, when Singapore was founded first, or discovered by an Indonesian prince, he built the first castle or a fort on top of this hill. So it was way, way back. It was even before. So Singapore was supposed to be founded by this British guy called Sir Stamford Raffles. So we were founded by Sir Stamford Raffles in the 1819. But this Indonesian prince, he kind of discovered us way earlier than him.
So it's like a Christopher Columbus story, right? Where one guy takes the credit.
Yeah. So he built a little castle on top of Fort Canning. So on top of this hill right now, there are still a lot of ruins, broken down pieces of bricks and foundations of buildings that used to exist. So people take evening walks. Just last weekend, I brought my dog for a walk there, and it was really nice.
Baxter!
Yeah, Baxter. Yeah, he loved it.
All of this nature exploration just reminds me of exercise, and exercise is already making me think about my hungry stomach.
Singaporeans are really health freaks. Everyone, even my age, can you imagine? Everyone is exercising in Singapore.
Wow. It's Wow. It's like, it's a culture. It's just what you do. Hey, friend, do you want to go for a jog together?
It's quite common. But, and I'll be up for it.
Okay. So I guess, you know, where could we find authentic, traditional Singaporean food, but for cheap? Where would we go, right? Because with travel comes food.
I think, well, I'm not an expert in food because personally, I'm not a big fan of eating. Yeah, it's true. However, it is true. But however, if you really want to explore the local food of Singaporeans, I think the best way is to go to like a local market. So if you come to Singapore and you go to the standard touristy places like Chinatown, you're not going to get anything really authentic, right? Anywhere in the world that has Chinatown may not necessarily have the best Chinese food. So when you come to Singapore, well, of course, I can give you some names which nobody will remember in a split second. But if you come to Singapore, you have to go to like not in the central area, not in the shopping area, not in the central town of Singapore, but like in the neighborhoods of Singapore where the locals really live. Like, do not go to the places where the foreign expats live, because they're just going to like fine restaurants and good fine dining or like nice cafes, right? You need to go to like a real you need to go to like a real local area, like somewhere further away from city center. And we call these places hawker centers. So it's like a marketplace whereby the locals go there in the morning to buy their fresh vegetables, fish and meat. And then usually at this marketplace, you also have a section where there will be stalls of different types of food being sold, and locals just eat it at the table. So you can go to a local hawker center, and then you just need to explore yourself. But I would recommend, if you come to Singapore, a nice area to go to would be Tiong Bahru. Okay. So I think Tiong Bahru is a great, Tiong Bahru, but it's a local name, so it's a bit difficult to pronounce. So Tiong Bahru is a good fusion of between the expats and the locals living together in harmony. So there's a nice mixture of cafes, nice restaurants, but also the local eateries and the local hawker center. So I think Tiong Bahru will be a nice place to explore. I love that area as well.
And at Tiong Bahru, will you find kaya toast? Because apparently that's a popular Singaporean snack.
It is. It is. It is a very popular breakfast snack. So in the morning, you would have kaya toast. So the kaya toast is basically two toasts on top of each other. And then between the toasts is a spread of a kind of, well, I wouldn't call it butter, but it's a spread that is made of pandan leaf and egg. So it's very hard to describe. It's sweet. It's
sweet. Okay.
Yeah. Have you tried it before?
No, I've never tried kaya toast in Singapore.
Yeah,
kaya toast. I was so disappointed when I found out there was such a snack named after me, I was named after it.
I'm not quite sure if you like it, but if you have a sweet tooth, I think you may like it. It's interesting because when you first told me your name, that came to my mind as well.
Really?
Like, yeah, when your dad first told me about your name, I was like, you must be joking. Kaya is like this thing that we eat in Singapore every day.
It's like kaya. What is kaya?
But I think kaya toast is a morning thing, but it's not really the most popular dish in Singapore. So, and I don't think I don't think everybody would love it, but there's one thing that the locals and people who visit Singapore would definitely like it, which is called chicken rice. Chicken rice is big in Singapore, and there's a popular debate between who created chicken rice. Was it Singaporeans or was it the Malaysians? Well, it's not important, but one thing for sure is that it's the biggest and most popular dish in Singapore. It's called the Hainanese chicken rice.
I'm totally gonna have some next time.
Next time, come back without your dad.
I'll be traveling. We'll do the college student bucket list.
Good.
Everything that's mentioned here will be done.
It'll be exciting.
So I guess a really interesting thing that we were actually talking about. And unfortunately, I wasn't able to wear my Singlish shirt because all of my stuff is in quarantine from college and everything is just all over the place. So I wasn't able to find it because I took it with me to college because I would wear it often. But I know you're not a fan of Singlish, but tell us more about it because I think it's so remarkable. I think it's so interesting.
Well, first of all, what is Singlish? So Singlish is a collaboration between English and Singapore. So it's Singapore's English. So putting them together is called Singlish. I'm not a big fan of Singlish because I just think, in my opinion, it's not proper English. But it's also the best way to communicate with people from Singapore, especially from the older generation. So back in those days, like maybe my parents or my parents' parents, literacy rate in Singapore was really low back in 1960s, in the 1950s. So every people, like we have many races in Singapore and everyone speaks their own dialects. So like the Chinese speaks different dialects. There is a Cantonese, there is Teochew, there is Hokkien, there's many different dialects, and it's actually not mainstream Mandarin, and they do not know how to speak English. But over the years, as Singlish develops, it kind of gels everyone from an 80-year-old grandmother to a 10-year-old grandson. Like everyone could speak in this common language called Singlish. So grandma does not know English, grandson does not know how to speak dialect, which is like maybe Hokkien or Teochew or Cantonese, but eventually they are able to communicate through Singlish. So the good thing about it is it brings us together. But like I said, because I'm a teacher, so it's not proper English, and therefore I try my best not to advocate it or to use it. Yeah. So as you can see, from my accent, even you see like, I'm a Singaporean, so when I speak, my accent is really strong for a Singaporean. But imagine now I start speaking Singlish, which is not proper English. I don't think this talk show could go on.
If you wouldn't mind, if it wouldn't hurt your ears too much, would you mind giving us one sentence in Singlish?
Okay.
I know it's much to ask from you.
So for example, in Singapore, okay, in US, what do you call this?
An iPhone.
Okay, and then if it's not iPhone, the proper term for this would be a...
smartphone.
A smartphone or mobile phone, right?
Yeah.
In Singapore, we call this a handphone.
Oh, really? A handphone?
Yes. So we call this a handphone because in Mandarin, a handphone, I'm going to speak Chinese. So in Mandarin, this is called 手机. Now, 手机 literally in English means hand and phone. So we are so used. So when most Singaporeans speak, because their first language, most of them are Chinese or Mandarin. So they think in their head as hand and phone. So when they speak it out in English, it becomes handphone. So I remember that when every time I travel around Europe or I go to the States, and I say, oh, where's my handphone? Everyone is like, what's that?
What are you talking about?
So that's an example of Singlish. And the other one, it's like again, because it's translated from Chinese to English. So let's say if I want to ask, where is your hotel at? So Singaporeans wouldn't say, where is your hotel at? They will say, at where?
At where?
At where?
At where?
Yes. Well, of course, with my strong Singlish accent. At where?
Wow.
So we will really cut it short and make it as convenient, like I said, because Singlish is like a great communication tool between different generations across. So we try to make it really simple. So instead of saying, where is your hotel at? Or where is it at? We will just say it in the most simplified manner, which is translated from Chinese to English, and it's called at where.
At where?
And that's an example. Yeah, and that's an example of Singlish.
Wow. So now I know two words. Yes. I can be like, fun fact, guys.
So handphone and at where. So you could put them together.
Handphone.
So where is your mobile phone? It becomes handphone at where.
I'm going to try that. I'm going to try that with my mom and see how she reacts. She's going to be so confused, just as confused as I was. But that is really interesting. Really cool. My first Singlish.
Yes, and because this Singlish is so, it's so popular, and like we have kind of make it as a joke and even market it out to people visiting Singapore. And if you come to Singapore, it's just like a t-shirt that says Singlish. You could come to Singapore and a lot of tourists would buy souvenirs that says on t-shirt Singlish. Or even if you go to some big bookstores or bookshops, they would have local writers writing on this topic called Singlish. I think these are great books to buy because first thing is a souvenir from Singapore. And secondly, it really gives you insights into how this language kind of developed over the last 20 years.
That is a great tip, guys.
All right. So maybe I'll buy you that for your birthday.
Just coming up soon. I'm not saying.
Okay.
So basically, we've learned so much about Singapore, especially for us American people, American fellow listeners, right? There's so much about Singapore that we really don't get to understand and see. So important to actually try to think outside the box and to try to get as close to the culture and just close to living as a local as possible to really get that authentic and full experience. And we may know that Singapore may be known for its chili crab and its tropical climate and its no gum chewing policy, right? But if you were to define what the best quality of Singapore are, that just to kind of give a representation of like your heritage and just your home, what would you say it is? Besides all of the stereotypes and the most popular, popular things, fun facts.
I think Singaporeans, if I have to put it in a few simple words, I think Singaporeans are really hardworking. Like we are a bunch of hardworking people. We are really friendly. So Singaporeans love foreigners from everywhere in the world. You could be from Europe. You could be from the States. You could be from Latin America. You could be from Africa and all parts of Asia, Middle East, Australia. Singaporeans love visitors. They love foreigners who work in Singapore. And we are always friendly. We are always interested to make new friends with them, especially the younger generation. So like if young Americans come to Singapore, they will be very popular with my students. So yeah, I would say friendly, hardworking. And I think one last thing I would say, because that kind of also summarizes me as a person, as a Singaporean, I think we are really proud. We are a small but proud nation. Like we are proud of the heritage, how far we've come for the last 50 over years as a small country, how much we've grown, matured over the last 50 over years. We are proud of what we have. I guess that kind of sums up what a Singaporean would be.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Alvin. Speaking to a true Singaporean here.
Indeed.
It's really awesome. It's really awesome to learn about Singapore, even after not being there for so many years, right? It's even being there for just a short period of amount of time, I learned that there's still so much that I have to see. There's always a chance to go back and to learn more. And I'm excited to do that. So hopefully when the pandemic is finally over and the world is back to safety, we will meet again soon, and I'm very excited.
I'm sure we'll definitely meet very soon. Otherwise, your dad will be nagging at me.
That's true. It'll be the Three Musketeers once more, with a slightly more mature Kaya and less annoying.
No, stay this way. This way, you're fine.
Okay. Thank you so much for joining me.
All right. No problem. Thank you.
If you've made it this far in the video, thank you so much. That was like an hour worth content, and this is my first time. This is my first time doing a YouTube video like this. This is the first time hosting a show like this. I really hope that you guys enjoyed it. I'm always welcome for any feedback and any just comments. So you can just comment down below on this video. For the following weeks, you can actually catch my show Sunday at 2, The Speed Escape, on iHeartRadio, and I'll make sure to have the YouTube videos posted Sunday at 2 as well. So I'll be more punctual. This is a first time, so just bear with me. But overall, I love traveling, and traveling is such a passion. Every time I go away and I visit a different country, I pretend like I'll never go back there again. And I'll pretend like, you know, I kind of just remind myself that if I do go back to the United States, like work begins and school begins. So I always try to really just take in everything that I'm seeing and really appreciate it. Singapore has been one of the most beautiful, unique countries that I've ever visited. And I'm just so happy that I did. And I can't wait till I visit Singapore again. And yeah, so guys, I know we're in quarantine, or at least we're still in quarantine. Things seem like they're just kind of stuck on repeat, but I honestly kind of wanted to start this show because it's kind of like a reminder that, you know, there's so many great things in life that you just have to look forward to, and also that you could still be home, but you can also kind of put your mind into different places and start your college budget, like, bucket list. Like, this is the time. You have time for this now. It's summer. You've got, you know, you're home. But yeah, but I really hope that you guys like this show, and I can't wait to see you guys next week. Bye.